There can be three methods of inviting investigation, either on the report of the registrar, or by the central government, or by the resolution passed by the company itself when the shareholders feel that the management of the company is defrauding them. And if a resolution is passed or the central government feels or on application of the registrar, an investigator is appointed to investigate into the affairs of the company. And if you go through the provisions of the Companies Act, you will find that once an investigator is appointed, he is not limited to that very company. He can also, by seeking permission of the central government, start investigating the related companies also. Like holding company can also be inspected, subsidiary company can also be inspected. And over and above the investigators, which were also there in 1956 Act, Companies Act 2013 have introduced another office called Special Finance Fraud Investigating Office, SFIO. Now, if there is a financial fraud being conducted by the company, then this office can start investigation, and all other agencies have to support this office, SFIO. This is a new office being created by the central government. Over and above investigation, the regular investigation, SFIO, there's another aspect which is called oppression and mismanagement. Oppression and mismanagement is where the minority shareholders of a company feel oppressed by the majority. Because it's a democratic process. Everybody is a shareholder, but does not have a control on the management of the company, despite being a shareholder. So you are basically, by purchasing a share, a part owner of the company, but you have no say or no authority as an owner, because predominant decisions are being taken by the management, who has the majority shareholders with them. Similarly, like our general elections, those who are getting votes higher than the opposition are forming the government. Same thing, whether you like it or not, the majority shareholders hold the management of the company. Despite you having a minority shareholder, you don't have much say. So you may feel oppressed. So to protect the minority shareholders, exception to the rule is, what is the rule? The rule was established in a leading judgment of Foss versus Harbottle. Foss versus Harbottle brought a doctrine that the courts will usually not interfere in the management of the company. That is the rule established by Foss versus Harbottle. But the exception to rule is oppression and mismanagement. The exception is fraud. That if there is oppression, there is fraud, deliberate attempt to sideline creditors, or forgery being committed against creditors, there are exceptions to Foss versus Harbottle. So oppression is like exploitation. If a minority feels exploited by the company or by the management, 100 shareholders in number, or 1/10 shareholding into the capital of the company, either of the two. Suppose if 100 people have one share each, or one person have 1/10 shareholding, that is a qualification to move court against oppression and mismanagement. One can go to the court to look into the affairs of the company, because it is alleged that the company is grossly oppressing and mismanaged. And if the court finds that yes, oppression and mismanagement is being conducted in the company, the court can take over the management or remove the current management of the company. That is the provision of operation and mismanagement. Moving ahead, there is a new act brought in 2016, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016, INB Code. Now, the winding up of the company has been dealt by INB Code, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Whereas Section 371 of the Companies Act 2013 also deals with the winding up. Now, the winding up has to be done by filing a petition before National Company Law Tribunal. So, after the formation of NCLT, earlier the winding up powers were with the High Court, now they have brought before NCLT. And under Section 371 of the Companies Act 2013, there are certain areas which is given. Only on those grounds a winding up petition can be filed. Like if the company is unable to pay its debts, or the directors of the company have not filed the timely annual returns, or there is a resolution by the company itself to wind up the company, or if the tribunal feels that the company is acting in mismanaged fashion, or if there are ultra-virus activities going in the company, and if it is just and equitable to wind up the company. These grounds have been given under Section 371. If you observe, you'll find. On these grounds, a company winding up petition can be filed before National Company Law Tribunal. And remember, the winding up is a process. It is not the end of the company. During the winding up process, a liquidator is appointed to look into the affairs of the company, who invites even the creditors of the company, whatever, to put their claims before the liquidator. But this winding up process under the supervision of NCLT is a process which ends with the dissolution of the company. So winding up is not the end, dissolution is the end. Winding up is a process. And once the dissolution happens, the order of dissolution is to be submitted before the registrar of the company, who on the basis of dissolution deregisters the company. And once it is deregistered, thereafter that's an end to the company. Because till it remains in the record of the registrar, you may be misled that the company is a running concern once you take an inspection. So after dissolution, the company has to be deregistered from the ROC. These are the touchstones of the Companies Act 2013. I know that the Companies Act is a vast act, though curtailed in 2013, refined to some extent, it does not have the privilege of the lengthiest legislation, which was 1956 Act. Now it has been cut. 1956 Act had 658 sections, which was the lengthiest legislation, more than IPC. But 2013 Act has only 470 sections. So it has been curtailed to quite an extent. But even Now, it is one of the lengthiest legislations. And if you include the supporting legislations like INB code, etc., it's a huge area. And I understand that the entire act cannot be talked to you in one session, but I tried to cover the major areas, the touchstones, the important aspects of the Companies Act to begin from the beginning to the end. And by this, a comprehensive idea about the Companies Act, and if those who have made notes, I'm sure you can go into a detailed study, and it will not be that repulsive. A little understanding will definitely be there. And in case you, after this comprehensive study, start studying those judgments which I have told you, those sections which I have told you, and if you develop certain confusions, I'm sure your faculty will be happy. Because no confusions is a dangerous proposition. If there is no confusion, there is no question, sometimes it is a significance of ignorance. And those who are ignorant are at bliss. Ignorance is bliss. Humko pata hi nahi hai, toh hum khush hai. Lekin pata lagane ke liye, confusion ke raaste se guzar kar, jab aap clarifications laate hain, then you gain knowledge. So may be possible that after today's session, you may develop certain confusions. But if you develop certain confusions and clarify from your faculty, it is a good sign. Then you are understanding the subject. So I hope that you will come out of, you will develop confusions and come out of the darkness of the confusion by the end of the session and clear the subject of company law with good marks. And later on, may you be attracted to company law to enter into the profession from the area of corporate and company law, which is a very, very lucrative, very attractive, but a very hardworking area of the law. I wish you all good luck. Thank you so much.